My name is Sharon Quinn, and I'm also known as the original runway diva, and you are watching Model Behavior. Class is officially in session. Today, my guest lecturer is Naimah Terry. Naimah is a successful plus-size model and a fit and showroom model for major brands ranging from Levi's jeans to David's bridal gowns. She is also a recent graduate from Rutgers University with a BA in planning and public policy, where she concentrated on community and real estate development. Welcome back to Model Behavior, Naimah Terry.
Thank you so much, Sharon, for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you back. And when you know, half of the reason I brought you back is because when I had you on the first time with the rest of the models, you let me know that you were doing accounting, or I guess taxes you were doing?
Yeah, I was trying to study finance. I was actually working on getting my Series 7. But I had to pull back a little bit and focus in on modeling. I switched agencies and things just kind of took off, and I had to refocus and make that money.
Why did you switch agencies?
I was not happy with my agent. In the beginning, you know, when your pitches aren't that great and you submit to all the agencies, and I didn't really get good feedback. So I end up getting with a lot of smaller boutique agencies here in New York City. And what I came to realize is, while I was maybe their number one girl on that board, I had like capped out or reached my peak with the agency. So
really?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, the former agency that I was with, and I have no doubt that they're going to be a great agency eventually, but they're still building their relationships. And that didn't mean that my career had to wait for that agency to build their relationships with clients. I needed to go somewhere.
And you age out in this business really quickly.
Exactly. So I needed to get with somebody who had the clients already, who had established, you know, connections and a great board so that, you know.
So how long did it take you to figure out that you had gone as far as you could go with that agent?
You know, honestly, before I signed, I was kind of thinking it in the beginning, but like I said, none of the bigger agencies would take me at the time. And that agency was, they did keep me working, and I did learn a lot there. But I only signed a one-year exclusive contract. And as that year was approaching, I said, you know what? I need to reach out. I'm a little bit more experienced. My pitches are a little bit better. Let me reach out to other agencies. And I got some good response. So this is very important, very key models. When that 90-day contract is about to end, you need to submit your 90-day notice, certified mail, let them know you are leaving your agency.
So you have to give your agency 90 days notice?
You have to give them 90 days notice. And a lot of times we think we're friends with our agents.
Oh.
And
that we might be, but not when it comes to business.
Not when it comes to business. So you think you can go in and have that, a conversation with them and have a heart-to-heart with them and express your unhappiness and express that you're going to look for other agencies in. I had none of that in writing, so they held me for another year. Well, they tried to. They tried to.
Really?
Yeah, they tried to. So it was, I went a whole year. I had left them. I had to get lawyers involved and everything.
Wait, let me just ask, but when your contract ends, it doesn't automatically renew.
If you don't give them...
If you don't give them a 90-day notice, it automatically renews?
It automatically renews, yes.
And it says that in the contract?
It says that in your contract.
Wow.
Yes.
Y'all better be reading these contracts.
Actually, no, you need, because I end up spending a lot of money on a lawyer after the fact. Hire the lawyer in the beginning to read over your contract, even though if you think
Don't sign anything without having somebody.
A lot of us don't. We're so excited that somebody's interested in us and we sign. And there's a lot going on with this per client contracts now with the smaller agencies. And it's just like, no. Have a lawyer read over your contract and, you know, really make sure that's the agency that you want before you sign.
And
anything.
You have to have chemistry with whoever your agent is going to be.
Yeah.
Because if you don't have that chemistry, or you get an agent who doesn't really like you, you're going to be sitting on the board doing absolutely nothing.
Okay, so interesting enough, you said that. So I was actually, I'm going to spill the beans. I, when I left my agency, I was going to go to Muse. I had a great conversation with them. We're going to take you on board. And I thought my contract was over at that point. Didn't know they held me for the, you know, for the extra year. And while I was in the process of getting out of that contract, me and the agency, me and Muse were in communication like every day. And literally 3 months into me trying to leave my old agency, they're like, we decided we don't need you on our board anymore. Yeah, so it's like I ended my old contract to go to a new agency, and they decided in the middle of me leaving the old agency that they, you know, they just reevaluated and it wasn't the right fit. So, you know, I think everything that happens is meant to be. It was
a
blessing.
You wasn't supposed to be there.
I wasn't supposed to be there. So if I would have signed right away with her, she still 3 months later would have been like, I don't think she was right. So I'd have been sitting on her board doing what, you know?
And so they'll sit you on the board rather than to release you from the contract?
Yeah. If they think that they can, you know, make money off you, they don't want you to go someplace else. I've heard of people signing people onto a board just because they have another model that looks like you,
yeah,
and they want to keep the competition away.
It does happen.
Yeah.
It's not necessary.
No.
But it does happen.
No, it's enough clients and enough money for all of us.
So say that again. How many times do we have to say that?
Yeah.
The pie is big enough so that everybody can eat.
You're right.
You don't need to be full, you just need to be satisfied.
Yeah.
Anyway, how long you been modeling, Naimah? And how did you get into the modeling thing?
So professionally, I have been modeling for about 3 years now. Mm. And I say professionally, whereas I'm actually making money and I got to pay Uncle Sam and all that good stuff.
Yeah, that comes with it too.
Yeah. So in high school and fashion show, high school and college, I would do like the local fashion shows and just fashion shows on campus. And like, when people were playing basketball and stuff, I was, like, in the Vogue Club because it was just like, I'm not playing no sports. I'm not doing none of that.
The Vogue?
There was a Vogue Club in my high school.
You let me find out you a little girly girl, Naimah.
Kind of. I was. You know, I was. I had, like, my Barbie sheets and stuff growing up. But anyway, so once I had graduated, I didn't think it was an option. I didn't know that I could actually make a career out of it. So I was law school bound. I was going to take a whole different route. And I actually got invited to a fashion show. And it was a redress fashion show. Do you remember?
Oh, yes, I do.
I got invited to the show, and it was all plus size models on the runway. And I was like, what? Like, this is the thing? Like, this is happening? And I actually saw you and Gwen DeVoe there. And I remember looking at you, the ladies, like, who are these two, like, confident, like, women just in this room? I think I actually went up to you guys and was just like, oh, my God, you guys are beautiful, da-da-da. But, you know, I was, like, very timid and shy back then. And I was just like, wow, this is a whole industry. It was a room full of plus-size women. And I was just like, this is what they do for a living? I was like, okay. So I started researching, talking to models, getting into fashion shows, being at the right places and just networking. And
that's called doing your homework for y'all that don't know that. Yeah, this comes along with it.
Yeah. So I was inspired from that day. And I was like, screw this. I'm not studying for law school. I'm not doing that right now. Who knows? It might come back in the future. But, you know, my career just kind of, once I started the ball and I kept going, I kept my eye on the prize and I'm working.
And how did you get that first, the first person that signed you, how did that happen?
Actually, I was in a fashion show in New Jersey. I met Trisha Campbell, Christina Mendez, Jeannie Ferguson.
All have been on this show.
Yeah. It was so many greats there. And I got to talking to them, and they told me about fit modeling, try some of the smaller agencies. And I did. I got a lot of advice from other models who were, I'm happy, were helping, you know, they shared with me their experiences. I actually got really good advice from Chastity Saunders when I first started out. And she told me, she said, if you're going to do a test shoot and you don't know what else to do, she's like, go in Lane Bryant, go in Ashley Stewart, buy the outfit that's on the mannequin, wear that outfit to your shoot. And I was like, okay, that makes sense. Because obviously they put it on the mannequin for a reason.
Makes perfect sense.
They put it on the mannequin for a reason. I was like, wow, okay. So it was just like taking all of the information in and using it, basically.
That is a good piece of advice that I'm sure nobody thinks about.
Yeah.
Because that, it's already perfectly styled.
It's obviously the way that client wants it to look. So, you know,
okay,
shoot it, yeah.
So now you're doing fit?
Yes.
You're making a living from doing just this?
I'm a full-time model.
So what's your hustle like? That's what I want to know.
You know, it's a pretty good hustle. It is a pretty good hustle. Wednesdays are my busy days. I call Wednesdays my money days.
You fitting clients all day long?
Yeah, like back to back to back. So most of my clients fall between Monday through Wednesday. I try to keep it that way so that...
So you have your time to yourself?
Yeah, it's like not my time to myself, but just to have flexibility for other clients. And, you know,
okay.
Thankfully my fit clients have been flexible enough because they know I also do shoots. So that's been a blessing. And just to work with some amazing brands and be behind the scenes and looking at fashion literally being created on you, you know? Actually, this was a sample from when I was fit modeling for Eloquy, and it's just like, you know, you get to see...
Ooh, I like Eloquy. Y'all don't even know. I love them. Yes.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's pretty awesome to be in this industry.
Now, tell me, because in order to work and fit on the regular, there's some stuff you gotta do.
Yes. The number one thing is, it's almost God-given. Like, you got to have the measurements. You got to have that body. A lot of times, I know people are like, okay, if I gain weight or if I lose weight, I can beat these measurements. And it's just like almost
you gotta
like...
You got to keep those measurements. They have to be natural to you, right?
It just almost has to be natural. You got to kind of be solid in a way. Like, even though you can have the measurements, you still have to be proportional. Your body still has to be toned. You know, you could be an 18, but some people are sloppy 18. Some people are like a loose 18. It's hard to fit. It's hard for a designer to see you in their garments if you're not, you know, toned and proportional and maintain your measurements. And it's, you know, having the personality, being flexible.
And I would think that it'd be easier to maintain your measurements if it's something that's natural to you.
Exactly.
Yeah, so you going on some crazy diet, and you might look good, but you're going to lose that client by next month because you ain't going to be able to keep it there.
You're right. You're right. And they do notice. They notice everything about you. Oh, Naimah, you gained weight this week. You should eat salad for the rest of the week.
Do they? Yeah, well, I've heard this from Tisha Cameron. They're very blunt because that's your job. This is what you being paid to do.
Yeah.
So you can't allow you can't really cheat and have that Snickers bar if it's going to sit on your belly.
No, you can't. I mean, it's like some tricks of the trade. If you're going to be working out, you know, eat before you go to that client. You got to know your body. You got to know your body. You could literally like breathe
in. So you don't
want
the client to see you eating?
Not necessarily. Oh, well, they shouldn't know. They should just think that you're naturally maintaining those measurements. But, you know, if you had a good workout this week, if you were, because I work out, I'm not that consistent, but, like, when I'm working out, I make sure, like, I'll eat before I go to a client so I'm nice and full.
Mm-hmm.
It's so much to it, but you just really have to know your body. Like, sometimes you could feel it. I could feel if I gained 5 pounds, and I'm like, okay, wait a minute. I'm messing with my money right now.
I know, see? I know that's right. That's why Sharon Quinn has never been a fit model. Because I likes my chicken and my potato salad.
I do.
Okay, I'm just going to tell you.
I do, too.
But let me just say, if I was making steady fit money like that, yeah, my focus would be on the prize.
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, I'd be string bean thin. I don't know what I'd be doing, but I'd be making it work. Okay. Now, how many... So you have your fit clients. Do you have all your fit clients are here? Do you travel to some of them?
I not consistently travel. The only time I've ever had to travel was with one client to China, actually. So that was a pretty awesome experience, and it was kind of nerve wracking when it first happened because I got the Naimah, can you stay a little later? We need to talk to you. So I was like,
oh, I'm about to get fired.
Then I was like, do you have a passport? I'm like, yes. So you're like, well, we need to go to China. Okay. I called my agent right away. Going to China. Like, what's this day rate looking like? Because you know, it's...
Talk about a day rate, because a lot of girls don't know what that is, because some of y'all ain't ever going to see that.
A day rate in this industry could range for if you're doing a showroom to if you're getting booked on a campaign, could be anywhere from... about $800, or maybe on the lower end, $500, all the way up to $3,000 right now.
See, back
that's
in my
the
time.
Range. You guys are getting the big bucks.
Yeah. Yeah. Read it and weave, okay?
You guys are good.
They ain't paying them sort of salaries no more.
No, I've heard. I'm a little jealous. I'm a little jealous. I wish some of that money would come back.
Those were the good old days, baby, flying us first class. What? We was having a ball. No. But, so you went to China. How long did you stay there?
It was a 6-day trip.
And then you worked while you were there.
But we were only actually in China for 4 days. Like, the first day was traveling, last day traveling back. And for those 4 days, we were in a factory. We were in a different factory every day, literally, trying clothes on. I was jet-lagged. I slept in a closet one day.
It wasn't the least bit glamorous.
It wasn't the glitz and the glamour, but it was definitely an awesome experience. Because the factories over there, so basically with fit, the designer draws the concept or the buyers come in and knock off somebody else's design, and they send those specs to China. China makes a sample, they ship it to the United States, they fit it on me, and that's the process. They make revisions, send it back to China, they fix it, and that goes on until a sample is perfectly made.
So you really can't gain any weight.
No, because it makes a difference. It makes a difference. They're working, they're shipping. Do you know how much money they're spending just shipping garments back and forth to fit? But when we got to go over there, they don't see our bodies like this. When they saw me, they're like, oh, wow, because it's like a voluptuous woman, but still proportional. Mm-hmm. And it was great for their vendors and their factories over there to actually see the body so that they can know what they're doing. Because a lot of times it gets lost in translation because they're not used to seeing this type of body. Mm-hmm. They might have bigger women over there, but that don't mean that they're looking like us.
And that would explain why when they try to knock off the stuff, it doesn't fit.
Oh.
That makes perfect sense to me
now. All these little brands popping up now, knocking off the major brands.
And selling the $80 dress for $10.
Yes.
But it doesn't look, they stealing the picture from the website,
yes.
But what you're getting is not going to look
like
that picture.
No, it would never fit like that.
Wow. Yeah. And even if you, because my girlfriend said she got her wedding dress from China, and they fit it to her they fit it to her measurements. And she tried it on. And I saw it. A couple people saw it. Baby, that wedding day, she took a breath. The whole back of that dress bust out.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We had to put a pashmina on her for her to go down the aisle. Yes.
Oh, no.
So I would never order something like that.
No.
It would be bigger. I would send it for bigger men, and then I could get it taken in here.
I'm a fit model. I'm the plus fit model for David's Bridal. So you brought up wedding dresses. And literally, it's crazy, and I'm so happy they have the money to spend. But they will bring a fit model in and book a half hour or an hour, literally to move something a quarter of an inch.
Because it matters.
It matters on bridal.
Yep, it matters.
It needs to fit you perfectly.
And you don't want to be that one that is not a pleasant feeling.
No. No
and
made
I
in China.
I did laugh. I'm not gonna lie. I didn't laugh in her face, but I did laugh. I'm sorry.
You have to.
It was funny. I'm sorry. Anyway, so now you're fitting clothes. Fitting clothing and lingerie, is that two different things?
I fit everything. I fit for Adore Me, so I'm there.
Oh.
Yep, I'm there. So go ahead. Actually, you know what's so crazy about this industry? I remember Trisha saying this on your show. It's like once you're in, you're like in.
Asia Monet said the same thing.
Because everybody moves around. So I was fitting for Kmart and Sears, and they went to San Francisco. Their whole team, everybody. And that was in their Varick Street office, went to other companies. So my TD, that was at technical designer, at fashion Kmart, she moved to Adore Me. And they had no plus size model. They were fitting on a size small girl that had triple Ds. And when she came in, she was like, how are you fitting plus size on this size 6 girl with a big bust? It's just like, nothing's ever gonna fit right. So I didn't even have to cast for that. And this became a
regular. She just called you.
She called me and she was like, Naimah, I need you to come to the client. Thank you. And this is my steady client. I fit with them every Monday and Wednesday.
So what do you need to build up these relationships? Because if you weren't the person that you are, if you weren't pleasant and people like you, you wouldn't have gotten that call.
Hell no.
That's just how I cuss all the time. So right, tastes good in
no,
my mouth.
Not a shot in hell. Not a shot in hell.
So how do you go about? What do you think is the best way to cultivate these relationships once you get in the agency? Because you don't want to be the chick that's constantly ringing, on the phone, in your face.
Yeah. You're right.
You know, being a pain. So how do you cultivate this without being a stalker? Because that's what it turns into.
Oh, God. Okay. So besides being prepared, and being prepared is your body being prepared, maintaining your measurements, having the look, I would say, because I've seen some people not get clients because literally their weave is too messed up. You got to remember, we're in a, when you're fitting, it's not glitz and glam. You're in the room with mostly tiny Asian ladies, I will be very honest. You're in the room with Asian ladies. You're in the room with a lot of designers. There are not many people like us in the fashion industry behind the scenes. So you're with people who are not used to seeing us changing our hair up all the time. Literally, I've seen it happening. Like, you know, she doesn't come in as groomed as she needs to be. So you need to be groomed. If you're doing lingerie, you need to... You need to not have hair in places.
Do
you
people
need to
have really have to tell?
Yeah,
yes, they do. Because when I was working as a booker, they was coming in with mustaches.
Oh God.
Goatees. I'm just like, you didn't even try to shave that off before you came in here. They come with no makeup. It's like, so you thought barefaced. Okay. I just need them to be smarter about it.
Just be smart. Be pleasant. You know, genuinely ask questions that you care about. I know, you know, we get paid a lot of money, but that doesn't mean, like, soon as your time is up, you got to be like, I got to go. Give them an extra minute or two. I'm telling you, they remember this. They do remember these things. Ask. If you notice something, how are you doing? Oh, I like your shirt. It's just simple. Don't be fake with it, but just develop relationships. And
so that they remember who you are.
Yeah. My technical designer that brought me to Dormy, she like, you know, she considers me a friend. She liked me so much, she literally pushed me on to shoot with Adore Me. And she was pushing for a long time. I've been fitting with them for almost a year now. And they booked me last November, something else I did not have to cast for. It's just like, you never know what it can transition into. You just gotta...
Since you brought up casting, how you ace the casting?
How do you ace the casting?
Yeah, that's what I wanna know.
I'm still trying to learn this.
Okay, but let me rephrase that question. How do you book the job?
How do I book a job? It's all about preparation. It's all about preparation. Again, maintaining your body. A lot of it has to do with before you even get there. Mm-hmm. A lot of it has to do before you even get there, taking care of your skin, having on nice clothes, you know, just coming in looking and feeling confident. And having a great comp card, because you got to leave them with something. You have to leave them with something. They see so many people, sometimes they can forget about you. Arriving early, which is something I didn't do today. But
see, but nobody knew that until you told them.
No, but you got to get there early. If you sweat a lot, you just have to know your body. You have to know you. So if you need to get there and prepare and powder up some more, then you need to get there early. Dress the role, be prepared, have a great comp card. If it's a walk, you got to have your walk ready. You got to be ready to take those Polaroids. Just know what you're getting yourself into.
Don't come to the casting and change your clothes in the bathroom.
No.
That is not a good look, and I've seen y'all do this a million times. You can go in there, freshen up. Don't change your clothes. It's not your dressing room. And people see that sort of stuff.
And research who you're going to see. Everybody is Google. Well, is on Google. Research. Let's see if you can find a picture just so you can know, because you might see somebody coming up in the elevator with you. Mm-hmm. Know who that person is. Know who you're going to see, because it makes a difference when somebody hears their name. But it's just stroking the ego.
And in fit, is it? Would you think it's smart to learn some background on the company that you're trying to work for?
Of course, you got to know. If you know you're going in for a casting or a go see, for instance, right now, Eloquii is looking for a new fit model. They put it out to the public. They're looking for an in-house fit model.
What's that?
18. They're looking for about 12.
Well, I ain't no 18 no more.
No, get out of here. But they're looking for somebody for like 12 to 15 hours a week. That's a lot of money potentially as you could be booking
Absolutely.
Directly. So if I were preparing for that, I would be networking around. Who has the insight if I'm not an agency model? Mm-hmm. I would be networking. If you know, whatever, try to get somebody's contact or just email directly. But order some stuff from them. See how it fits on you.
Yeah,
order the clothes.
They have great
spend the
stuff
money.
Too.
It's an investment.
I like that, the website.
Yeah, buy the clothes. Look at the size guides that they have on all of these websites.
Why is that important?
Because you can see if they're looking for, if they fit on a size 18 or a 14 or a 16, whatever it is, you can look at the size guide. Am I these measurements? All of these websites have the size guides up there. So you know what you are. You got to know before they even get there. I know I'm your size 18, or I know I'm in between your size. So I might can pad up a little bit here. You got to know. It's all about being prepared.
That's really good advice. And the size guide, yeah. I'll be honest, I didn't know about that till you just said it. Our hustle was a little bit different because we didn't have the internet back then, and there was no size guide and all of that stuff. We went to the back of the page, where to shop.
Gotcha.
You just hit up everybody on the back, and whatever came back, but you threw it all out there. So what's next for you now? Are you trying to get more print clients, or you trying to get more fit clients?
I'll take a little bit more of everything at this point. I'll take a little bit more of everything. I'm happy that I'm with a new agent right now, Dorothy Combs Models, and I've only been with her since February. I've booked a shoot with Kmart, Avenue, JCPenney. I've worked twice. I've got to fly to Chicago, to Dallas to work. So things have kind of picked up, and I'm really excited about that. I'm happy to keep working with her. I do want to get a New York agent. So right now, she's working on my book. My book is very commercial right now. Which commercial books you those clients I just named? JCPenney, Kmart, Ashley Stewart. I've worked with Fashion and Figure.
Do you do editorial? Do you do any editorial?
I have not been booked on much editorial.
Now, see, I can't go into this because we only got about 2.5 minutes left.
Oh,
but I want to know, what makes an editorial model? Because I'm looking at you, your eyes been twinkling since you got here.
Yeah.
And that makes me want to look in your face. So I don't understand why. I think you would do well as an editorial print girl.
You got to know you too. As soon as I get in front of the camera, it's like my smile.
See, that's
the smile goes right there.
So editorial is not smileless.
Oh, see, I don't got that.
And I don't do that.
When it's time for me to do it, I don't do it. Some models have it. That they just turn the sex on and all of that. And I'm over here like,
no, I'm commercial. Hi. And that's I make money off my smile.
Exactly. I'll
give you that all day.
I will take it. I will take it.
All right. Naimah, before we go, you got a website?
I do.
Throw it out there.
My website is naimahterry.com. And please follow me on Instagram, Snapchat, at Naimah Terry.
You're not on Twitter?
Oh, and Twitter. Yes, I'm sorry. Thank you, Sharon.
Instagram?
Facebook, everything is the same. I'm very simple, Naimah Terry.
All right, guys. We are almost out of time. I'd like to thank my guest, Naimah Terry, for sharing her industry knowledge with us. Now, before I go, as always, I'd like to leave you with a few thoughts. I want you to, one, remember that you can't change the game until you first learn the game. Two, always surround yourself with positive people and positive things. Three, do what you love and love what you do. And lastly, be who you are, but be who you are tastefully. Always have some class about yourself. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and Pinterest. If you missed an episode of Model Behavior, now you can catch all the previous episodes on our YouTube channel. Just Google Model Behavior with Sharon Quinn and all of the previous episodes will come up. Thanks for watching Model Behavior, and I'll see you guys next week. Class is officially dismissed. Bye, y'all.